Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming this afternoon. This afternoon we celebrate the graduation from Shekou International School of the class of 2020. And first, a thank you to our wonderful strings group who played that beautiful prelude music and will play the session. Thank you also to Ms. Michelle Collin, who coordinated the photo shoot that provided many beautiful photos and video elements that you'll see tonight. It has certainly been a very different year, and we are very fortunate to be able to sit here tonight. A month ago, we were unsure if we would be able to hold any ceremony at all, and it is only within the last two weeks that we were able to come back to this beautiful theater and continue the tradition of graduation here in the Mountain View Theater of the Design Society. During the ceremony, can I please ask that you put your mobile phones on silent or vibrate to ensure the ceremony is not interrupted. Please also be aware that we have a photographer and videographer, and this event is being live streamed. So in respect to those who are watching from home, please minimize the use of your phone cameras so that everyone can enjoy the event. To start today's proceedings, I would like to invite the strings group to play the fanfare and processional while our class of 2020 enter. Please remain seated.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please congratulate the graduates of the class of 2020. Once again, to our parents, guests, teachers, and especially the class of 2020, welcome to this very special graduation ceremony, a once-in-a-lifetime experience for our graduates. So, strange as it may be to say, I feel very fortunate to have joined SIS this year. In choosing to come here, the most significant element was the community that I heard about when I talked to anyone who had taught here or worked here or gone to school here. And the strength of the community is revealed most clearly in difficult times as we all continue to go through. And so, I just want to say thank you, because it has been an honor, it's been a privilege to work with and to see these young people succeed in the face of such incredible, the word is cliche now, but it really, there is no other word, unprecedented times. And it is that strength that they have within themselves and that you give them as parents, as community members, as teachers, that will carry them through. So on behalf of the secondary faculty at SIS, I would like to wish our graduates all the best. I know that you are well prepared to tackle all the challenges that you will take on in your lives. And I want you always to remember the ability to learn, unlearn, and reflect that will carry you forward. To continue our ceremony, I would like to welcome our head of school, Mr. Gregson.
Graduates, parents, faculty, and to the many members of our community who are joining us on the live stream, welcome and thank you for joining us today. It's traditional at a ceremony like this to bring in a quote from somebody famous. This year is an unprecedented year, so the only one that I could come up with was an Australian philosopher named Steve Irwin. And the quote that most aptly sums up this year is, "Crikey!" Now that I've got the quote out of the way, you've probably heard of a thing called 20/20 vision. It means being able to see the whole picture clearly. And hindsight is being able to understand everything as you look back and see what's already happened. So 20/20 hindsight vision means you have the ability to see clearly what's in front of you and understand where you've come from. Graduates, you need both. Luckily, you get 20/20 vision from genetics, from good people who are sitting here watching you this afternoon. And hindsight, you get through education, the good people who are sitting here or are joining on live stream. And with 20/20 vision, I can say that this is a remarkable year. The impact of the pandemic and the reverberations that have echoed through the world will last in our memories forever. The acclaimed business writer, Simon Sinek, he writes that thinking gets you the best results in life. There are two ways of thinking. You can think that life is a series of finite games, or you can see that life is an infinite game. Now, a finite game is like basketball. You know the rules, you know when it finishes, you know who your teammates are and who your opponents, and you know what winning means, how it's defined. And then there's the infinite game. And it's infinite because there's unlimited choices. You don't know what the rules are. They change all the time. You don't know who's on your side or as an opponent. You don't know when the end of the game will come. And you don't really know what being a winner looks like, because it's undefined and can change in a heartbeat. This year, we've seen the rules of what should happen in the world turned upside down. Suddenly, the definition of what's important has changed. I never expected to see the International Baccalaureate and IB, the International Baccalaureate AP programs cancelling their exams. I never expected to see universities who agreed to look at the collective work and assessments from the schools in selecting their candidates. I never expected to appreciate the simple joy of walking on the boardwalk quite so much. I never expected to feel so much pleasure from sitting next to my friend. But I do. This year it became really clear that we need to understand that we are playing an infinite game. Don't try and plan for the rules of a game that may change. Don't set arbitrary and unreasonable expectations of when you need to achieve something by. You guys are remarkable. You've been graduating in a remarkable year. But the real reason that you're remarkable is because of your artistry, your care for other people, your intelligence, your ability to question and create ideas, because of what you've learned and what you understand, and because you're motivated to make real change in the world. Playing by an infinite game means that you need to make up your own rules. Play by your own rules. And in many cases, that would be a dangerous thing to say, but to these young people, I have no doubt that is the right advice, because they are remarkable. And they will play by the right rules because of their artistry, because of their care for other people, because of their intelligence and their ability to question and create, because of what they've learned, because of what they understand, because we've heard so many times of their motivation to make positive change in the world. We're fortunate to be sitting in a moment within this infinite game alongside our teammates. Once a gecko, always a gecko. Here, you can be sure who's on your side. Look around. These people will always be on your side. Look beside. These are your teammates. We're fortunate to be sharing this moment. I look forward to hearing more about this amazing group of people as they continue to play the infinite game. Thank you. Creativity. showcased in so many ways by these students. I'd like to ask Chanel and Jimmy to come forward and showcase one part of the artistry that is in this remarkable team of people. Thank you. Mr. Bywater and Ms. Krause
to the screen. These three caring mentors have been your advisors throughout the year, and you've asked them each to say a few words to wish you well.
A lot has changed, and there are many things that are uncertain. But uncertainty and doubt are not necessarily bad things. Your senior advisors are here, in body and in spirit, to talk to you tonight about some of our own experiences with ambiguity. To quote Shankara Vendatam, moments like this, moments of chaos and disruption, allow us to discover things about ourselves.
Who am I? You may be asking yourself this as you head off to university, the workplace, or a gap year. The question is one that most of us ask as we transition from one phase of our life to another. The future is here, and with it naturally comes uncertainty. Yet, some of you may be comfortable with the path you have chosen. You have confidence in the immediate future, the path you have chosen for yourself. However, that path may not be determined yet, and while we think we know, life has a way of throwing curves in what we thought would be a straight path. What happens when we come to a fork in the road? The poem, The Road Not Taken, by American poet Robert Frost, is often interpreted as coming to diverging paths and choosing what looks to be the path that is less trod upon. In this common interpretation, it celebrates the path that looks to be less traveled, a triumph of the individual spirit. However, when taken in its entirety, literary critic David Orr states that The Road Not Taken is a poem that repeatedly returns us to the same enigmatic, leaf-shadowed crossroads. As you come to those ubiquitous crossroads, you will choose the path that will undoubtedly be filled with uncertainty and unexpected curves. While you may be uncertain of your choices, the paths will take you to unique places and be filled with experiences that will help you answer, who am I? I too have faced what appeared to be the same crossroads time and time again, each one filled with uncertainty, and I often stood quivering, sometimes paralyzed, to make a decision as to which path to take. Sometimes I confidently and quickly chose what appeared to be the clear path. Other times my decision was fraught with anxiety. Each major decision, though, each path eventually took me to a clearing, an opening that revealed great possibilities. Currently, I'm faced with the uncertainty of my future as retirement looms just a few weeks away. I am walking straight towards the fork, and I don't know which path I will choose. However, I am now familiar with these crossroads and am comforted by their familiarity. No matter which path I choose, I am confident that I will once again be able to answer, who am I? As each of you embark on a new journey, be confident that you have already come to crossroads, that you have had to make the decision of which path to take. Reflect upon each decision. Recognize that you have already faced difficult decisions. Be confident knowing that you have faced the crossroads multiple times. Be comforted by their familiarity, knowing that you can do it again and again and again, as you too answer the oft-repeated question, who am I?
Even the most scientific among us face uncertainty as they seek to understand the four our world.
Hi, seniors. Uncertainty in physics. Martin, I can hear you groaning from here. Anyway, uncertainty in physics is quite an interesting concept. The purpose of real science, biology courses excluded here, is to be able to understand the world around us, to use that knowledge to be able to predict what will happen in any given situation. Indeed, classical physicists believed that if they took enough data, if they had enough information, if they measured enough things, they could predict what would happen in any scenario. However, as scientists learned more and more about the world around them, and as they dug into nuclear and quantum physics, there came a point where they started digging into that theory and realized that things were actually less predictable than they expected. Quantum theory includes such uncertainties as the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. That basically states that the more you know something about a particle's position, the less you know about what it's actually doing. Think of a photo that you take with a camera, right? You can set a high shutter speed or a low shutter speed. Look at this first image. The first image is taken with a high shutter speed. You can see the tennis ball sitting right there, right? It's very clean and crisp. We know exactly where the ball is. The question is, what's the ball doing? We can't tell, right? We can't tell if the ball is moving down towards the ground, if it just bounced, if it's moving upwards now. We don't even know if it was inbounds and going out, or if it was outbounds coming in. None of that we can tell. All we can tell is where it is. Okay? Look at this second image. In the second image, we have a slower shutter speed on the camera. Alright? Now, this time, you can see the motion of the ball. Right? You can see, but now it's so blurred that we don't have a specific location for the ball. This is basically Heisenberg's uncertainty principle in a nutshell. Either we can know where something is, or we can know what it's doing. But there's a limit as to how much we can know about the other piece of that. All right? So, a law of uncertainty that you may be a little more familiar with is that of nuclear decay. About half of you took a real science class. Once again, bio. Sorry, not included. Okay, not really necessary. But, basically, you learn that given a material, that material has a certain half-life. The half-life of that material tells us how long it will take for half of the molecules in that material to change to become something else, right? To decay, carbon decay, or uranium decay, right? Those different types of particles that you've learned about, they will change, and we can make very good predictions about the material as a whole, about the whole group. We cannot, however, it's impossible to predict when a single particle will decay or change from one substance to another. We can't do it. There's some uncertainty there. All right. This leads us into some very interesting scenarios, such as Schrodinger's cat and wave-particle duality, and other scenarios that led physicists to assume that objects are in a state of constant flux, varying probability until they're observed. Schrodinger's cat is assumed to be both dead and alive inside of its box, with finite probabilities of both. And not just it's one or the other, but it's actually both and can be both until the box is open and we see, and then collapses into either it's dead or alive. Electrons passing through a double slit are assumed to pass through one slit or the other slit, and actually one and the other, and both of them at the same time, and until we actually observe what they're doing, at which point it collapses and we can see what's going on, we can see where it is. Now, the idea of uncertainty in the quantum world was hotly debated. Einstein himself rejected quantum theory. He said, God does not play dice with the universe. Basically, what he meant is that probability doesn't fit in with our concept of science. Uncertainty doesn't fit in with that idea. However, all evidence has pointed to the fact that uncertainty is real. It's a principle of physics that's now universally accepted. My physics kids know that I'll always jump at an opportunity for life lessons. This is one. Just as uncertainty is a principle of physics, it's also a life principle. There's times in our lives when things are uncertain. I was in one of these uncertain conditions a few months ago when I told SIS that I wouldn't be returning next year. I didn't have a new job lined up, nor had I even started searching. The time of uncertainty was highlighted by several variables, such as I was an experienced teacher, and yet I had 4 trailing dependents, all of whom I loved, none of which I was willing to leave behind. Finding schools in great locations with minimal benefits and other schools that had great benefits, but the locations were vetoed by my family. I talked to schools around the world. I was offered several jobs. I was hoping for jobs that were never offered. It seemed that the more I researched and the more I learned about schools, the more I talked to them, the less certain I was of where we would end up. One thing I learned was that if I could get them to talk to me, to meet with me in person, my charming personality usually won over my inability to write formally, further evidencing my belief that all that stuff about stylistic features, juxtaposition, anaphora, anachronism, alliteration, and all that other stuff you learn in IB English are pretty much unnecessary. Over the course of several months, we were able to come to a decision regarding our next location, which even now, with the uncertainty of COVID-19, is a solid point for us to focus on as things around us continue to be somewhat crazy. I feel like a particle in Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Sometimes, having a solid ground, like when I was home at SIS in Shenzhen, I didn't see the future, but I knew where I was. I couldn't tell where I was going. Other times, I could see the future clearly. Now, I know where I'm going. I know I'm going to Oman, to Muscat. And yet, my current situation is very wobbly and unsteady, very uncertain. Graduation is a time in your life that you will be like those particles. You know exactly where you are right now. You're finishing a wonderful period of your life, all here, tonight at graduation. Your here and now are certain. Yet your movement from here, the future, is highly uncertain. You'll soon be spreading all over the world. Some will stay on your chosen path. Others will change within the next year, or a year before graduation, as I did. You'll be learning more about who you are and your place in the world. You're much like Schrodinger's cat, in a state of constant flux. Though not a flux of dead or alive, it is a flux of all the possibilities and probabilities of who you may become. We all have to wait until a time in the unforeseen future when we will be able to observe you again to see who you are and what you have become. Of course, at that point, we'll no longer know in what direction you're going. Thank you.
You used about 3 stylistic features in that speech, Mr. Bridewater. I'll explain them to you later.
As Mr. Smith said, we refer to having 20/20 vision, right? In a literal sense, this means your eyesight is perfect. You can see what's in front of you, and in favorite expression, it means you can predict what is to come, you can see potential obstacles in the road ahead, you can plan for them in order to reach your goals with minimal interference. So, I think we can agree, class of 2020, it is ironic that your year of graduation, a synonym for clarity of vision and freedom from doubt, is one of the least certain times any of us have ever faced. But, again, as Mr. Smith already mentioned, there's another figure of expression, which is hindsight is 2020, which means that it is only after we have lived through an event that we can know what decisions, what actions would have been best. Until then, we can only make educated guesses, with an emphasis on the word educated. After all, that's why you're here. That's why you've always been here. To learn from each other, to learn from your failures and successes equally. And this moment is something to learn from. In my own life, I faced enormous uncertainty when I left the acting profession. I had no idea what would come next. I had no plan B. But then I discovered I didn't need a stage, necessarily, to indulge in the things that I loved about acting. I could explore language and emotions and identity and what it means to be a human without also having to engage in the daily business of self-promotion. I discovered that what I really love is not the spotlight. What I really love is a nice warm reading lamp. What have you discovered about yourself during this time? Did you learn what we already know? That you are strong, you are brave, that you can work through any obstacle, and you don't need certainty. As Mr. Bywater said, our world is always in a constant state of flux. What we thought we knew is often disproved, and we have to adjust our understanding of the world and our place in it. And as Ms. Krauss pointed out, asking ourselves to embrace uncertainty and choose a path despite not knowing where it will lead will allow us to learn more of who we are. You don't need 20/20 vision to begin this next phase of your journey. You are flexible, you have perseverance, you have courage, you have everything you need. The future belongs to you, and I, for one, am so grateful for that fact. So, Emma, Kevin, Leo, Jim, Hannah, Barbara, Martin, Kyle, Ben, Megan, Suman, Paul, Lotta, Carolyn, Andy, Jennifer, Chanel, Steve, Catherine, and Kelly, thank you. Thank you for being you. Thank you for showing us what true perseverance, flexibility, and courage looks like. Thank you, Class of 2020. And now it is my utmost pleasure to introduce the student speaker for the Class of 2020, Mr. Leo Chen.
I believe that the IBPT is a different monster,
a monster with a sample size so great that none of us would be here simply by luck. We've been tasked to double community service, extracurricular participation, in addition to academics, in 6 different subject areas. Perhaps we all have faltered in the face of this beast, but nobody, not a single one of us, has backed down and given in to the challenges that have come our way over the past years. I believe this speaks volumes not only to the individual abilities of each and every one of you, but to this very community that has nurtured our development up until this point. It is no secret that our school dwarfs in size compared to other schools. Yet one of the things that makes SIS so special is its people and the memories that I have the privilege to share with each and every one of them. We've been through lots together, but it is rather mundane happenings that always tend to touch my heart when I reminisce. I still remember quite clearly the Monday mornings when I would run into a certain 9MC doppelganger on the way to econ class. I remember the moments when Jimmy and I held in our laughter with all our might because we feared the wrath of our dear Chinese teachers. I remember the all-nighters that we pulled before finals, where we slept and studied in shifts so that none of us passed out all the way into the morning. I remember the weekly walls trip where we communicated solely by airdropping notes to one another because none of us had Wi-Fi at the Wu-Tang Paradise. And finally, who can forget the celebration of Yee Sin when he killed it on the drums at the talent show. These anecdotes are just the tip of a large iceberg. To each and every one of our soon-to-be graduates, these memories are proof of an eventful, dramatic, and storied journey. There were times that were strenuous. There were times that were disappointing, even. But never once did navigating these hallways in the past 4 years feel dull. In fact, it was at this small, unlikely school that I and many others met handfuls of individuals that taught us what it means to live, to forgive, to laugh, and to love. I was lucky enough to discover that the sensation of succeeding as a collective far exceeds that of succeeding alone. And so I formed bonds with many people, students and teachers alike. There are select few individuals here and elsewhere for those who are still stuck in lockdown that render the sensation of passing time non-existent. With these individuals, I don't really need a schedule or a plan. I'm more than happy to simply relish in their presence and the pointless conversations that go on and on and on until curfew. In the time that we have spent together, I hope you all have found friends like these. Friends that will fight for you, will support you, will celebrate you, no matter the circumstance. But perhaps it is because we share these bonds that our farewells will feel all the more painful. High school, like everything, has drawn to a close, and we must say goodbye to all things that used to be so familiar to us. I'm sure everyone here has some things in mind that they know they will miss. Maybe it's the views from the top of the peninsula buildings. Maybe it's the fact that you can literally jump on an e-bike and travel anywhere in Shekou. It might even be the escalator that our school has that escorts us up to class every single morning. But it won't be until we leave this home that we start to realize some of the things that are a little more trivial, some of the things that we might have grown accustomed to, or some of the things that we simply take for granted as time passes. The sound of your parents shouting your name in the hallway to wake you up for school. A hot meal whenever you're hungry. The certainty that there will be people there to support you and help you throughout anything that you stumble across in life. These are the things that will be no more once we depart our nests, once we bid farewell to those individuals who have provided us comfort and love over the past years. I still remember the things that we used to write in our yearbooks as kids. We used to sign off using hats, have a great summer. And in the case when somebody was moving, kids, keep in touch.
For the relationships that endured the test of distance and time, those friends could at least come back and visit the students who are still here. Yet this summer's a little bit different. By summer's end, the majority of us will have left for good. Either to a foreign destination for university, or back home to our native countries. And no matter how much we try to hold on, no matter how many times we say keep in touch or see you soon, the truth is that there won't be another Meet the Teachers Night that will reunite this class of 2020 ever again. That is why, fellow graduates, I want you to take a look at the people sitting on this tube. This is the group of people that you will have graduated high school with. The group that has endured many of the same challenges and lived through many of the same joys as you. Now I want you to take a look at the audience. At your parents and your teachers, the adults who have provided you unconditional love and care over these past years, the adults who are here again to support you and to witness your growth. There's not much time remaining with these people. Once we say goodbye, we may never know with certainty when we will meet again. But while we can only relinquish control for when we are leaving, let us remember that we still have power over how we will depart. The uncertainty regarding our next encounters may be scary, but let it also serve as a reminder to cherish. In these final weeks, or final months in the case of families, I challenge you to take control over the last memories and experiences that you once have with these people. I challenge you to express sadness, gratitude, and care. To not solely assume that your loved ones know that you love them, but to show them through dialogue and action. I challenge you to depart high school with the fondest memories of and with these people. For they will serve as the mattresses that you fall back upon during tough times, and the strength that will hold your relationships together, even when you are separated by oceans. We all knew that this moment was happening. But as we celebrate the culmination of our high school education, we are also quite literally saying goodbye to the final moments of our childhood. The final moments where we can take refuge under the wings of our parents, and the final moments where we can frolic with our friends without worry. It will be sad, saying goodbye to the life that we have become so used to, the days that have become so comforting, and the city that has become home to so many of us. But knowing you all, I know that for each bit of sadness, there will be twice the amount of time. I have full belief that equipped with the memories, experiences, and abilities that you have forged here, you will have no problems tackling the challenges that will come to you in life. I have mainly been speaking on behalf of my grade thus far, but I would like to round out my speech with a personal message dedicated to you, class of 2020. I would like to thank you all for allowing me to fight alongside you. Thank you for making me angry, worried, but most of all for giving me so much laughter in the time that we have spent together. Thank you for putting up with my sarcastic comments and insulting quips. Thank you for putting up with me constantly trying to tease you and make fun of you. And most of all for putting up with me for not living up to the person that you wanted to be, only to accept the person that I really am. It really has been an amazing, fun journey with you all. And I hope from the bottom of my heart for only the best for each and every one of you. I hope to see you all soon, especially if you become rich. And keep in touch. It really has been a pleasure. Thank you all.
Thank you, Leo, for representing your class so well.
I really do look forward to the day when you and the rest of your classmates are running the world. We now have a very special musical item that was created by Mr. Krebs and Ms. Kutzia from afar. Please enjoy our high school choir and band playing Home. best. I would like to introduce the senior video, which has been compiled by Paul to celebrate the class of 2020.
You take that jump, don't feel you fall. Open the water rises, you move to wall. Open the crowd spins out, spinning your name. Hope that you fall in love, it hurts so bad.
note that many of our students will also earn the internationally recognized and respected International Baccalaureate Diploma, which they will receive following the issue of results in July. So I invite Ms. Paula Bruni, our university counselor, to the stage to announce the names, and Mr. Smith back to distribute the diplomas.
Thank you. believe when. 10 words ain't enough to tell what I've been through.
Enjoy a small selection of the DP Visual Arts exhibition.